make some room for other people. But we are the Frozen Chosen. How many of you people drove trucks here today? Yeah, I knew we'd have a high percentage of truck-driving people. That's wonderful. Well, I actually asked Shane to take a look. We were live on Facebook now, and I'm having a feeling we're going to set our record today on the amount of people watching live on Facebook. So hopefully we'll see that pretty soon. But if you're at home, we're glad that you can tune in and stayed safe. Thank you for coming and joining us via your pajamas this morning. For those of you who are here, thank you for coming. I tell you, we say this, we want to make sure people stay safe, but the rule of thumb, I'm old school when it comes to this. I'll get here whenever there's church, because I have a four-wheel drive, and we'll have church no matter what. We're hardly ever going to cancel service. But by all means, we don't want people to think you have to come. If you need to stay home and be safe, you can do that. As long as two or three of us can get here, we'll be live on Facebook. But living in Michigan, that's just a fact. We probably won't be canceling services. Now, we don't know about Soul Fire today. So students and parents, what? We did cancel it. They did not cancel it. They're lying. It's going back and forth today. More than likely, I just gave Sam a hug up here, and I said, Sam, what's the percentage that we're actually going to have Soul Fire? And he said, I have no idea. More than likely, we'll be canceling Soul Fire tonight. And the only thing that would change that is if it stopped snowing now, and the sun came out and it got 80 degrees. So, he posted, we'll wait to make an official announcement at some point today, parents, about Soul Fire tonight. But thank you for coming this morning. Welcome to Oakwood Community Church. If you are visiting with us today, a double hearty thank you for coming out in snow to visit us for the first time. And if you are visiting us for the first time, we have a guest gift packet out in the lobby. Stop out there, turn in your little tear-off tab on the bulletin you were handed today. There's a little tear-off tab where you can put your information. If you turn that in, we'll make sure we give you one of those gift bags. Has one of our new coffee mugs from Oakwood full of goodies. And it's just our treat for you visiting with us. So thank you for being here at Oakwood. And again, I hope it's a special morning this morning. Maybe when we start the worship service and we stand up to sing, maybe we can gather toward the middle today. I don't know. I'm not going to make you do it. But it wouldn't be a bad idea if we all gathered a little closer this morning and snuggled, I guess. So thank you for being here this morning. Just a few quick reminders for everybody. I am so thrilled with the church's response last Sunday to our Christmas things that we're going to be doing to help around Christmas time, our SOS projects. All the presents were accounted for last Sunday. Every one of them taken off the tree. What a great thing that you responded the way you did. And so now all we need is you to bring those presents in, unwrapped, bring them to the church. You can turn them in at that table. And we are going to have a gift wrapping party next Sunday. Pray that there's no snow on Saturday. But we're going to have a gift wrapping party next Sunday. Well, now we need all hands on deck because we need good gift wrappers. They're going to have specific instructions for how we wrap and tag and make sure we know which present goes to which girl. That all needs to be handled carefully. But we also have to put together 250-plus mugs. Those are the mugs we're going to hand out on Christmas Eve. We've got two projects happening. We've got those gifts coming in for House of Providence. We'll have special people wrapping those that can wrap without making a mess. Then rest of us, we'll be gathering to put those mugs together. We've got our coffee mugs, and we're putting a hot chocolate packet and a spoon with chocolate on it in there and some other little goodies, and we're wrapping them up with cellophane. All that has to be done next Sunday so that we're prepared. On Christmas Eve, we need about 45 to 50 volunteers that would take the mugs. Depends on where you go, how many you'll need. And you'll make that delivery. We need people making those deliveries. This thing got out of hand quick. It was a wonderful idea. When it first came to the table, like, oh yeah, we'll give gifts to the people who are working on Christmas Eve. We'll do Whartonville. Can't be that many people working. We were thinking 100. We were thinking maybe 125 at the most. Well, our SOS team started calling all the businesses in Whartonville on the 15 corridor in downtown. Ends up with them and all the fire, police, sheriff, all the people that have to work on Christmas Eve. We're up to about 250 mugs that we need to wrap next week. and we need you to go to deliver. What does that mean? Well, you can just sign up on the form to say, my family's going to be making, we'll make a delivery for you. And then we'll assign those on Christmas Eve. We might send you with one mug to go to the marathon station on 15th, and you're going to go deliver that mug. We might give you the box of 40 mugs, and you're going to Beekys. I think there's 40 people working on Beekys on Christmas Eve. And all you have to do is walk in and say, hey, I'm from Oakwood. These are the mugs we talked about. Merry Christmas. You don't have to give big speeches. You don't have to stop them from working. A lot of the managers are worried. They don't need to stop the flow. You don't have to see every worker. You just make the delivery, and then you go home. And that way, we're doing an incredible thing this year, guys. We're touching a lot of lives this Christmas holiday. The girls at House of Providence, everybody that's working on Christmas Eve in Brandon, plus Oxford and Brandon's fire, police, and emergency services. All that is happening, and we're excited about it. So thank you. Be a part. Sign up. Those of you who are at home today in your pajamas, make sure you get signed up next Sunday to help us. All right. One other thing I was going to mention. Tell me. Yes, that's a really good thing. Come on up here, Shane. Well, friends, this has been an incredible week. When I mean incredible, I don't mean good. I mean this has been a hard week around Oakwood. We've had a couple of deaths. We've had a couple of funerals. We've had lots of medical emergencies. I've been in hospitals more this week than I think I have in the year and a half that I've been here. And plus, a lot of heavy things that people are going through. And then on top of it all, today, Pastor Shane and I were bringing all of our staff over to my house. We're going to have a little Oakwood staff Christmas party. We're going to feed everybody lunch and just thank them for all they do. And we were going to present them their Christmas bonus there from Oakwood. And at about 9 o'clock last night, my son started throwing up. He came down with a flu bug last night, and he's sick. So at 9:30, we're calling all the staff saying, "You're not coming to my house." And they were very thankful. So in lieu of that, we'll make up that Christmas dinner for our staff. But we want to let you know that we appreciate our office staff. I'm going to ask Fran and Melissa if you'd come on up here. I know you hate that, but come on up here anyway. And as they're coming, we got a text right before I had to cancel our lunch that Cheryl Bongiorno has to jump on a flight. Where is she heading to?
Tampa.
She's got to go to Tampa, Florida. Her mom has had a stroke. And so we wanted to let you know that Cheryl Bongiorno is part of this wonderful team of Fran, Melissa, and Shane and myself who work here at Oakwood during the week. And we are so appreciative of them. And we were just going to give them their bonus at the house over lunch. But since we're not doing it, I thought it'd be nice to just present them with a little token of a gift from us at Oakwood. Melissa's going to be roughing it on a cruise ship for the next 3 weeks. So she's leaving. So we thought we'd take care of it today. And so maybe this will help tip the porter or something. So, seriously, we do thank them. Thank them for all they do. They mean a lot to us. And you can have a seat. Thank you, ladies. And I just want to say thank you to Pastor Shane. Everything you see on the stage today, a total reset for our stage. Shane works so hard. He was here till like 2:45 on Friday night in the morning. I actually had to stop for a moment because the police showed up at 2, knocking on the door, wondering what's going on. Are you stealing stuff? He had to produce ID that he was who he said he was. So I tell you, I say this all the time, and it might get old. I don't want it to get old, but we are blessed to have a Pastor Shane who is dedicated and wonderful to run down.
Just me. I can't do all the creative stuff and things like that. I can put some lights together and do the big plan. We had lots of people helping out and making that a reality. Jim Bongiorno stepped in and helped me able to be here till 5 a.m. I think he helped 3 hours or so that night getting some of it done too. So a lot of people helped out. Appreciate all of that. I was watching our Facebook live feed, and we don't have quite as many people watching online as we have here this morning, but we're definitely breaking some records there as people are home. And you know, PD, I thought we did have to cancel service there a few years ago, and we had a couple Sundays where the power was out. So the good thing is today with Facebook live and technology, if we have to cancel service because the power's out here, you can still sit at home with your guitar and preach to us from your recliner in your Christmas pajamas, and we'd still be able to enjoy worship service at home. And so amazing things you can do with technology these days. I won't belabor announcements, but I did want to make sure we're clear on what's happening with Facebook, because obviously there's Soulfire, because obviously there's some confusion there. So Bobby said by 3:30, they're going to make a decision. They'll post that information on the Soulfire Facebook page. So parents, families, I'll be looking there for that information. You can find that on a link from our website if you don't know exactly where that page is. But most of the Soul Fire parents are in a group there, and they'll post that information out. So obviously, we love to gather together for our ministries, but we want to keep people safe, and they'll make that decision here a little bit later today. We do have a lot of things coming up over the next few weeks. This week and next week are pretty typical Sundays as far as the schedule is concerned, so 10:30. We're in the midst of this Words of Christmas series for the next 3 or 4 weeks. But we do have our Christmas Eve service that's on the 24th, the Saturday, and we're doing it at 2 p.m., a little earlier than usual, so that I won't interfere with early or late family celebrations and gatherings you might have that day, where we can still get together and celebrate and worship together. We got a special day planned there, full band, and some fun things we'll be doing to celebrate and worship. And then Christmas Day, it's going to be a special morning. We're going to gather together. We're not going to have any of the children's ministry, so it's going to be a family Christmas morning service. We'll sing some carols. We'll have a message. We've got someone that's created a special kid-driven skit for us that day. So it's going to be a great time. We encourage people to come for both if you can. If you can't be here for both, be here for one, and get on Facebook Live and watch the other. But we're looking forward to celebrating Christmas together. And then with the whole Sunday schedule this year, New Year's Day actually falls on Sunday as well. So what we're going to do that day, we're going to push the start time back, but at 10:30, instead of starting the service, we're actually going to have breakfast here. We're going to have some food here. I invite you guys to come out, start the new year right, mix and mingle, eat some food together, and we'll delay the start of the worship service till about 11 o'clock that morning. And so we'll still try to wrap up by about 12:15 with the service, a little bit more condensed. But that's going to be a special day, and PD is going to be giving a kind of an annual State of the Church address, kind of just giving an update on the vision and where we're at and where we're going. So it's not a day you want to stay home and miss out. Make sure you still plan to be here on New Year's Day. We can kick off 2017 right, connect with each other, hear about some of the things that are going on and some of the things coming up in the next 6 or 12 months as well, and we're looking forward to joining with you that morning. So be sure to check it out. We'll be handing out our newsletter for December today. It has the information in there about those things as well. So look at that, and we'll make sure everyone's aware of what's coming up. Let me see what else. Make sure I didn't miss anything. One thing, as we look at our offering, we have our special Oakwood Cares offering next week. And I think PD mentioned that. So that's coming up. It's something we've been doing every year the last 5 years, and these funds go to bless people in our community, but they also now are funding our SOS, our Serve on Saturday outreaches in the community. So this is a way for us to continue to be generous, to bless people in need, and to get the word of Jesus Christ out there as we serve and make help people in practical ways throughout our community. So we encourage people to give generously to that. As you look in our bulletin, you'll see as well, we keep it updated with the weekly financials. You'll see we're definitely behind budget this year. We just paid for, I think we had the money in the bank to pay for the heater. It was about $25,000, which was considerably less than we were originally thinking was going to be. But just so you know, as you're giving at the end of the year, some people think about year-end giving, things like that, we are a little behind. We encourage you guys to give generously to Oakwood Cares, but that will be above and beyond your general offering here to support the ministry that God's calling us to here at Oakwood as we seek to do His work and make His word known in our community. So those are things I want to make sure you're aware of. Let's pray. One thing I also wanted to make sure people know is Libby Grozek here is getting ready to move to New York. And this morning is Libby's last time leading worship with us at Oakwood. And so she's been doing that faithfully for a number of years. She's led with the Soul Fire crew back in the day before going off to college too. So we might see her a little bit the next week or so.
Next week's
her last week. So be sure to say thanks to Libby and be praying for Brian and Libby. It's exciting there in New York. He's our pastor, just accepted a new role there. So they're not just leaving us. They're going to spread God's word and serve there. So bless them, pray for them. And Libby, we're thankful for your love and your ministry here with the Oakwood family. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much. Thank you that we do have a warm place to gather together and for getting us here safely as people travel to and from here and other places. Keep me safe today. And Lord, we want to give you the glory as we gather together today. We want your name to be lifted up as we celebrate the birth of Christ over the next few weeks. Lord, we want people to come to know you and for people to find hope in your name and in the reality of the gift of your Son. coming into this world, and we're so grateful for your love for us. Lord, we do thank you for Libby and Bryant. Thank you for Libby's ministry here as part of the Oakwood family for so many years, and for her faithfulness. We pray as they move that you bless them, that you use them, that you multiply them, that your kingdom would grow there as they build into the lives of the people you're entrusting to them in that church, and that you bless them with a family away from a home that they can gather together and grow with. We just look forward to hearing news of your work through them. So, Lord, as we think about Oakwood Cares and our opportunities to partner with ministries and to bless people this Christmas season, Lord, we want to do that to be generous because we know you've been overly generous with us and in the way you've poured out your love. And so we pray as we do that, that people would sense your love for them as well and that you'd be glorified. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand with us. Let's continue our worship this morning.
Thank you. Two things you told.
God, we are so thankful for you, for your strong love that is stronger than anything that we might come up against. Father, your love that's so strong for us that you sent your Son. For God so loved the world that he sent his one and only Son, that whoever should believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Father, thank you that you have empowered us through your Son to do your ministry, to do your work, and we ask that now as we come into a time of giving, that you would bless this offering and that it would be sufficient for the needs of your ministry and for the work that Oakwood is doing in our community. We ask all of this in your name. Amen. You may be seated. Jesus is coming soon. Service, that the words spoken would bless our hearts and would help us to grow in wisdom and knowledge in you. In In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Church. No, we enjoy all of it, and that's okay. So this Christmas season, I want you to just sit back, relax, think about all the words associated with Christmas, and enjoy it all. This morning, we're going to look at Luke chapter 2. You can turn your Bibles there. I'd encourage you to get your Bibles ready to fly this morning, your electronic gadgets ready to go. We're going to go to a lot of passages this morning, but we're going to talk about some specific words found in Luke chapter 2. Let's pray this morning. Would you pray with me? I'd ask you to pray this prayer. You don't say anything out loud, but if you just say, God, if there's anything you want me to hear this morning, I'm willing to listen. Just give that prayer to God. God, if there's anything you want me to hear, I'm willing to listen. And God, I do pray that you'd be glorified. God, that everybody here would be edified. If they're at home in pajamas, they'd be edified, and that Satan would be horrified. So we pray that in
In Jesus' name, amen.
Luke 2, verse 10 is what we're going to cover this morning. The angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people." There's some great words there. And we're going to focus on what the angel said in Luke chapter 2 this morning for our words of Christmas. The first words that we see in there are, "Fear not." The angels break through. They break into the shepherds' lives. The shepherds are out in the field. It's dark. Great representation, by the way, of mankind sitting in darkness, and God breaks through. And here are the shepherds. Boom. God breaks through. And every time in Scripture, when angels appear, the first words out of their mouth have to be, "Fear not." Why? Because they're just about ready to freak out. I mean, you would too. We don't have a clear picture of what angels look like. But we do know that it's not what we've made it to be. The commercialism of angels with the, you know, chubby little babies with wings. And it's not that. The only descriptions we ever have of angels, they seem to be very large and strong, flaming sword kind of people. More like warriors and lots of light. So can you imagine a dark night near Bethlehem? And then from the sky, breaks through this massive light. And the angels have to say to the shepherds, "Fear not." We're going to start there this season with the word "fear not," because I think it's the most appropriate place to start. The shepherds were afraid. They were definitely afraid. They're not sure what's happening to them. But I think there's something much deeper than that. Fear runs deeper than just shepherds in the field. From the beginning of time, I think fear has been the thing that we experience the most on this planet. Fear. Everybody say fear.
Fear.
We experience fear. I go back to, even in the Old Testament, we preach through the Gospel Project, Adam. What happened after sin entered the world? Remember, there's that moment when Adam and Eve have chosen to sin, and then they're embarrassed, they're afraid, they're ashamed. And the Bible says that God shows up, and what do? They hide. And when God brings them out, he asks them, "Why are you hiding?" And what was Adam's answer? "I was hiding because I heard you, and I was afraid." Everybody say afraid. I truly believe the symbolism here in this passage in Luke 2 is these shepherds are in darkness, the angels appear, and they're afraid. And that's been the symbolism of all humanity since the time Adam and Eve sinned. There's fear. And real legitimate fear. There's fear of God, there's fear of eternity, but there's fear of lots of things. And I want you to know that this Christmas, when the angel said, "Fear not," you need to know this Christmas I can have faith instead of fear. This morning I want to give you hope and know that you can have faith instead of fear. There's lots of fears, friends. Health fears. I told you in announcements this morning, I've never seen a time. This week has been a whirlwind of people's fears, especially when it comes to health concerns. We've got people near death. We've got families making critical decisions for their other family members. And we've had people in the emergency room in the hospital this week. It's just been a week filled with fear. Every time the phone rang, it was almost like Julie said, you better check. It's just been one of those weeks. Fear. Health fears are real fears. And there's a lot of that happening right now. There's family fears. People struggling in their families, and there's as we get toward the holiday seasons, we gather sometimes, and that fear of gathering together because we're going to have to deal with Uncle so-and-so or Aunt so-and-so, there's fears, even in our own immediate families, our children and parents, and what's happening. Are we getting along? Are we honoring God with how we're treating each other? Instead, there seems to be fear. There's financial fears. Oh, lots of fears when it comes to that, especially this Christmas season, right? Oh, how am I going to pay for all this? How are we going to afford all of this? And remember, I told you a couple of weeks ago, if you commit to give to God, like we should be honoring God with our giving, it should be the first thing we do is give to God, and then the rest God gives us to spend wisely. And instead of giving God first fruits, we tend to hold out to the very end because you never know, the car might break down. Remember, I told you that. If you commit to God that you're going to give sacrificially, I'm guaranteeing your car will break down. Or you'll have a bill you did not expect. It's just the way life is. You're going to be challenged. And financially, this is one of those areas where
faith or fear? Faith or fear? We all struggle with that.
The IRS sends a letter and says, we've changed our mind. You owe the full amount. You've got to pay more than you imagined you were going to have to pay. Does that happen? Happened to me this week. You hate it when you get that letter in the mail. The big letters, IRS. Oh, no. Fear. Right at Christmas time. You know, you go, come on. Come on. I even called on the phone and said that to him. Come on. This was settled back in August. It was done. And you wait till December. Yeah. Fears. And that's nothing. Nothing compared to what is happening throughout our church in this past week of death. Bruce, we've been praying for your family, loss of your dad. And I'm going to tell you, church, I mean, that's a hard thing to go through when a family loses their father, their grandfather. And I'm going to tell you, Bruce, you did an excellent job at that funeral, speaking truth, speaking faith in the midst of a lot of fear. At the beer busting funeral here just Thursday, and the loss of a son who wasn't even 40 yet. And parents aren't supposed to bury their kids. Brothers and sisters aren't supposed to have to say goodbye. Those are real fears. Those are real hurts. And I think this morning what I want to get across to you is that I want to start this Christmas on the down note of, let's face the facts, there's a lot of fear. Cheryl's on her way to Tampa. Mom had a stroke. There's a lot of fears. You know, and on and on and on and on. It just seems to keep going. People are facing incredible, hard moments in life. Moments that you never imagined you were going to have to face. Decisions you never thought you would have to make. People here at Oakwood are just walking through fear. The valley of fear. I want to start Christmas on that note because I think it's important to stop and just take a breath and realize that when the angels broke through into the darkness of humanity, and it can be dark, the first words out of their mouth was, fear not. Everybody say, fear not. Fear not. I want to let you know the best words of Christmas are going to come out of Luke chapter 2. And the first word I want you to know is, fear not. Fear not. It wasn't just the Old Testament with Adam. You go into the New Testament, you think about the disciples. Well, what's the number one thing you think the disciples faced? Fear. Remember they're in a boat, and the storms are coming, they're all going to die. Remember the moment when Jesus is sleeping? It just drives them nuts. You know, they're in the boat, and Jesus is sleeping. And they're about ready to die. The boat's going to capsize. And they're like, wake up! We're afraid! You should be afraid with us! And Jesus is like, fear not. The disciples constantly fear. What about blind Bartimaeus? He was afraid he'd never have sight again. What about the 10 lepers? Remember the 10 lepers? That terrible skin disease? They were afraid. They would never see their family again. Never be able to hug your kids or your wife. They were afraid. What about Mary and Martha? They lost their brother Lazarus. They were afraid. There's a lot of fear. You'll notice in Scripture there's a lot of fear. From the Old Testament all the way through the New Testament, there's a lot of fear. And yet the angels broke through, and the first thing they say is, fear not! Oh, there's a lot of things to be afraid of, friends. But take heart. The Christmas story first starts with, fear not. Are you struggling today? We could probably just close shop right now. I could probably say, amen, let's go home. We just need maybe that this morning. The first two words of our series, fear not. Because you can have faith. You can have faith over fear. I want to boost you up a little bit this morning. I want to start by talking about Hebrews 9. Look at Hebrews chapter 9. This has to be the worst fear for everybody. What's going to happen to me after I die? But I'm going to give you hope because we're going to read some other scriptures this morning about faith. But first, let's look at Hebrews 9, 27. I hope this is not where you're at today. But Hebrews 9, 27, and just as it is appointed for man once to die, and after that comes judgment. Well, there's a lot to fear there, isn't there? The Bible says everyone has to die, and then they face the judgment. Those are two big things. Don't you admit that those are two big things we're afraid of?
And as Christians, we might get real spiritual, like we would answer the squirrel question with Jesus. If we're at church, we'd say, are you afraid to die? No, I'm not afraid to die. No, I'm going next. Oh, yeah, but come on. We're all afraid of that moment. We're all afraid to actually die. Is it going to hurt? What's going to be like? What happens? What is it? Death is a fearful thing. And then, what happens next? This morning, I want everybody in here to contemplate, what happens next after you die? Are you living in faith that you know what's going to happen next? Or are you living in fear of the judgment? I want to give you these verses, though. We're going to walk away from all the scary stuff, and we're going to talk about faith. Isaiah. Turn with me to the book of Isaiah. We're going to be going through a lot of scripture today, so be ready. Isaiah 41 and verse 10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Are you afraid today? Are you stepping through something that you never thought you'd have to be stepping through? Financial, health, family? Are you stepping through something right now that's shattering your faith? Listen carefully to the words. Fear not, I am with you. That's good enough for me right there. God's with us. He's with us. But then he says, don't be dismayed. I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I'll uphold you with my righteous right hand. Those are words of faith, not fear. Philippians 4, 6 and 7. Philippians 4, 6 and 7. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be known to God. And the peace of God, everybody say peace, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Peace. I often pray for that for you. This has been a week that I've prayed for peace for you more than I've ever prayed before. Because it just seems like it was such a suppressing week this week. Everybody's fears. And I pray for peace. You'll often hear me pray, God, please give us your peace where there seems to be no peace. There seems to be no peace. But we pray for God's peace. Are you experiencing fear this week? Are you heading into this December dreading, not knowing, are we going to get through this? Are you asking questions like, why God? Why us? Why me? Why now? Instead, I want you to know, have faith. Trust God. He'll give peace where there seems to be no peace. And in John 16, verse 33. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. But take heart, I have overcome the world. Friends, I want to remind you today, there's a lot of fear. There's a lot of things that can go wrong and do go wrong and are going wrong. But you can have peace because of faith. Is your faith bringing you peace where there seems to be no peace? Bruce, I love your testimony in the funeral for your dad. When your dad asked you, I want what you have. And he didn't even know what it was. His dad didn't know what it was, but he knew that Bruce had something that he didn't have. And his dad kept saying, Bruce, I want what you have. I'm not going to give Bruce his testimony, but I can just simply say, Bruce, everything in life isn't peachy for you, is it? Was your dad saying, I want the perfection that you have, everything goes right for you all the time? No, that's not what his dad was saying. Bruce has his share of struggles and problems. But Bruce has something that his dad can't imagine. Bruce has peace and faith in God. A faith that brings peace that makes no sense. And people want that. People want that. People look at us as believers and say, how can they have peace when there seems to be chaos? It's a beautiful testimony. And I want to encourage all of us in the midst of fear, live in faith. Trust in God. Look for him to break through and say, hey, fear not. I know it's scary. Fear not. had to start with that to get us to the rest of the words of Christmas. I love what the angels say next, because the angels say, well, you don't have to fear. We're going to go through those words. But I thought I'd start this morning by telling you a simple story to hang all this on, because some of you still might struggle with the lights and the glitz and the glitter and the reindeer and the Grinch, you know, and all those kind of things. And I'm over it. I've been over it for a long time. And I want to give you this story so you can maybe join me in my take on Christmas. Many years ago, during the Great Depression, a little boy heard that the circus was coming to town. He went to his dad and he said, Dad, tickets are only $1. And his dad said, Son, we can't afford it. His dad saw the heartbreak on his son's face, so he said, Son, listen, if you go out and try to help and work and do different things for different people, maybe you can earn some money. And if you can get close, I'll help you. With what you can earn in the next month, with what I can give you, perhaps we can come up with $1. So that boy went out and worked. He worked hard and he earned pennies and nickels and dimes. And during the Great Depression, he came up with nearly half of it. Went to his dad before the circus and his dad said, you know what, I think we've got it. They scrapped it all together, gave the son the money, and the son went and bought a ticket to the circus. He was just fired up. So excited that the circus was coming, and now he had a ticket. Well, the day of the circus was here, and the boy took his ticket and he ran to Main Street. And right down Main Street comes the circus parade. They're heading to the big tent. And here they come through town, and the boy's standing there watching as the clowns and the animals, the elephants, and he's taking it all in, and he's standing there so thrilled. And a clown came by, and the boy put the ticket he had in the clown's hand. And after the parade was over, he went home. He came running inside and said, Dad, it was great. The circus was amazing. And the dad was a little bit put off, saying, you know, it's a little early for him to be back already. And he said, Son, tell me what you saw. He said, they came right down Main Street, the clowns and the animals, and I gave my ticket to one of the clowns, and it was wonderful. And the dad said, Son, you didn't see the circus. You just saw the parade. The son thought that that's all there was the parade. And this morning, I just want to set the table for all this great gaudiness. And drive by my house at night because I want it to be seen from the moon. I'm of the National Lampoon's Vacation mode. And some of you might really be taken aback and say, no, that's not very spiritual. Can I tell you that all of the glitz and the glitter and the words of the pine and the hazelnut latte and all the stuff about Christmas that we might think is not about Jesus, can I just say it's all the parade? It's all the parade. And some people only get to see the parade. But we know there's more. We that have Jesus have a lot more than the world. And so instead of hiding in our churches and not having lights, I say we need more lights. Because I want the world to see this incredible parade, but I want them to ask, why do you have more? Well, they have lights, and they have lattes, and they have presents, and mistletoe, and pine, and all the wonderful stuff. They've got it all, but that's all they got. Without Jesus, you just get the parade. We get the whole thing. Because we know that what we celebrate amidst all the pines and the trees and the lights, we have the whole thing. And the whole thing for us is more than just the parade. It's God breaking through and saying, fear not! Fear not! So we go through this holiday season as children that anticipate a little more than just the parade. And I'm telling you, friends, get over it. Don't over-spiritualize it. Enjoy it all. Enjoy Christmas, every bit of it. Suck every marrow of life out of Christmas. Enjoy every moment. Because we're the people that get to have the parade and the whole show. And it's a beautiful thing. So light your houses. Light your trees. Let the whole world say, wow. I want them just to be blown away. And so we go big with our stage. And we want to just show all the glitz and everything that comes with Christmas because it's the parade. But it's not all there is. We know there's more. We know that God said, fear not. Faith overrides fear. It's appointed unto men once to die. Then there comes the judgment. See, for many people, that's fear, death, judgment. But for us, we have faith. So we know that death isn't final death. And we know that judgment brings love and grace. And there is no fear in dying. There is no fear in death. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, grave, where is your sting? For those of you who know Jesus, we have faith that overrides fear. So I say, bring it on. Bring on all the health things. Bring on all the financial things. Just pile it on. Go ahead, because I've got something that other people wouldn't understand. I'm still going to light the trees. We're still going to have more cookies than we should ever possibly make. We're gonna eat more goodies and enjoy more. And we're just going to take it all in. And you know what? It's all part of the parade because we have something so much more. We have all of Jesus. It's great. It's great. So what is so great? The angels first had to say, stop shaking. Fear not. I bring you good news. Everybody say good news. Oh, this Christmas, I can hear God's good news. Maybe you're here today and you're still like, I don't know. I haven't accepted this gift of Jesus. I know about Jesus, but he's not become my personal Savior and Lord. So what is this that the angels can break through and say, fear not? They say fear not because there's good news. And I want to tell you about that good news this morning. The good news is news of Jesus' birth. The good news is that Jesus was born. The angels show. And aren't you glad the angels didn't show up at the palace? Not our palace, where the Pistons are. The angels never go there. They're bad boys, right? The palace where King Herod was. Oh, King Herod. One of the bloodiest tyrants of all time. Herod was awful. You talking about fear then and now? They had a lot to fear when the angels showed up and said, fear not. Herod was awful. He was just insidious. He just wiped out people. He wiped out his own family. You couldn't even be married to him without being fearful. He killed his wives. He killed his sons. He killed anybody who he thought might rise up against him. King Herod was awful. And that's the story of the context when the angels show up. And they didn't show up at the palace. They showed up in the fields. I love that for everybody. It's for the common folk. The angel said, fear not. Fear not there's a tyrant. Fear not that you don't have funds. Fear not that you're struggling with your health. Fear not. I've got good news. Everybody say good news. Good news. Guys, the good news is that Jesus has been born. Yes, the world just sees the parade. And you might say, well, don't light your trees because they're going to think that's what you say. Well, let them see the lights at least. I want them to at least see the parade. I have the whole thing. I know what the whole thing's about. The angel said good news. And the good news is that Jesus has been born. We have a Savior. I'm going to get into that more in the next weeks because there's more words coming from these angels. I'm going to explain what that Savior is and who Christ is and what the Lord means, what Messiah means. All these wonderful words I'm going to explain. But let me just suffice it to say, the good news that brings no fear is that Jesus is born. Whew. Jesus is born. News of Jesus' birth is also true news. It's good news. Everybody say good news. But it's true news. Everybody say true news. News is news. And you know what's making news now is fake news. If you watch CNN and all these things, they're talking about everybody's upset about fake news. And I thought all news was fake news. I don't know where they're coming from. I've always had to think with my own head and decide what was true and what was not true. But now all of a sudden we're concerned about fake news. So we got fake news, real news. We don't know what this. And you know what? Let me just tell you. News. My wife isn't here, so I can say it. News ain't good news. News ain't good news if it's fake news. News ain't good news if it's not fact. You can come and tell me today that you're giving me $1 million. But Sam, if you offered me $1 million, I'm not going to be dancing. Because I know you ain't got it. You can come tell me news. You can share me news. But if it's not true, it's not good news. The angels broke forth and said, fear not. We bring you good news. Not only is it good news, it's true news. This Christmas, I want to let you know, we can have confidence that God's news is good news and it's true news. Look at Luke. Are we in Luke? I want to just take you back to Luke 1, verse 3. You all know that Luke is a physician. He's a doctor. He's somebody who trains and he looks for specifics. You want your doctor to be specific, right? Luke, in Luke 1, verse 3, he says this, "It seemed good to me also, having followed all things closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you." Luke sets out to tell us a detailed, orderly account of the birth of Jesus. Not only did he want to write an orderly account, he wanted to write a factual account. For all cases and purposes this morning, I really think Luke sat down with Mary. I think he got it from Mary's own mouth. Why do I say that? Look over to Luke chapter 2, verse 19. Luke 2, 19. After explaining all the things that happened with the angels and the shepherds, it says, "But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart." How would Luke know that if he hadn't been sitting there talking to Mary herself? I can imagine Luke sitting down interviewing Mary, the mother of Jesus, getting the first-hand account of the birth of Jesus, and it ends with Mary just saying, "Oh, I think about this all the time." So Luke writes, "I want to write an orderly, detailed account right from the mouth of those who were there. Hear it from Mary herself. It's a true account. It's not just good news, it's true news." Turn with me to Micah 5:2. Micah 5:2. Way back in the Old Testament. Micah 5, verse 2, it says, "But you, O Bethlehem Ephraim, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me, one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from old, from ancient of days." Friends, it's the true news. It was prophesied in the Old Testament that Jesus was going to be this baby who was born. And not only that, where he was born. It was going to happen in Bethlehem. And in Luke, we find out if it was in Bethlehem that the shepherds, "Fear not. I got some good news. It's true news. He's born." It's good news. It's true news. Luke chapter 1. Go back to Luke. Luke chapter 1. Verses 67 through 79. I won't read the whole thing, but we have Zechariah's prophecy. Zechariah's prophecy talked about who it was that was coming. It talks about John the Baptist who was coming before Jesus. And it all became true. Everything that was prophesied came true. Luke chapter 3. Go to Luke chapter 3, verse 23. Luke 3:23. It talks about the genealogy of Jesus. And as you look through Luke 3, 23 through 20, or through 38, it gives us the line of Jesus, born in the line of Judah from King David. It proves that everything the Bible prophesied about this child who was coming, who was king, was true. Everybody say true. I love that the angels broke through and it says, "Fear not, I bring you good news." Good news is true news. Jesus is the promised Messiah. We're going to talk more about that because there's no sense having a parade if we don't have the stuff, the real stuff to be excited about. We have the real stuff. The angels told us there's good news. But the angels also said, "I bring you good news of great joy." Everybody say great joy. Oh, there's great joy that comes with it. That's why I say, please don't try to bring me down. Don't try to talk me off the ledge when it comes to Christmas. I'm lighting it up. I keep putting more lights up. I'm probably driving everybody nuts. I start putting the lights on trees that aren't supposed to have lights on. I just get excited. I'm like, there's a tree. Where's the lights? Let's go. We have more extension cords and timers going on here than I'm sure you've ever had before. Because why? I just am giddy about Christmas. I love it all. Because the angel said, "Fear not, I bring you good news of great joy." Everybody say great joy.
Great joy.
You know, I'm not surprised the Bible says, unless you receive Jesus as a little child. Have you been around a little child around Christmas? Have you been around? Don't you love little children at Christmas time? The anticipation, the excitement, the giddiness? I just want to keep that child enthusiasm of Christmas. Josh and I were driving home yesterday. He's not here, so I can tell this story too. Hopefully he's sick enough that he's not watching. Josh and I went out Christmas shopping yesterday. I'm having a great time. We're out shopping, having a wonderful time, and we're driving home, and right when it started snowing yesterday, and as we're driving down the highway, we're having this heated discussion. We've just been to Starbucks. I'm just going to tell you flat out, my son ordered a vanilla bean frappuccino. And he used to give me a hard time if I'd order my tall, flat white. Every once in a while, I like the spiced tall, flat white. It's a good Christmassy drink. And he used to always say, you're drinking frou-frou drinks. I'm like, no, I drink black coffee. He's like, not that. Well, all of a sudden, he starts ordering vanilla bean frappuccinos. If you start ordering vanilla bean frappuccinos, you don't give me a hard time about ordering anything. That's nothing but cream whipped up in a cup. And he's sitting there sucking on his frappuccino yesterday, and he looks at me and he goes, boy, you ordered a boring drink. And he's sucking on, and I'm like, what? And so I start getting into it with him. And as I'm getting into it with him, we pass a car. Now, my son says I was mad at the car because it was going too slow. This didn't happen. He's got an alternate reality. I was focused on the frappuccino debate we were having. We were having a frappuccino debate. But as we passed the car, my son looked over and out of nowhere, full blown, it was Santa Claus driving the car. Full white beard, full hat, full suit, driving this little sedan down 75. And as we passed it, and I'm trying to talk to my son about the purity of good coffee, he stops and goes, ah! Santa Claus! And he just loses it. He looks at me and says, Dad! You were yelling at Santa Claus! I'm like, no, I'm yelling at you. No, you were mad at Santa Claus! I said, Dad,
you're going to hell. It was then that I started worrying about the theology. I started thinking about Christmas and Santa and heaven and everything. So we had a discussion about that, but he just lost his mind. He couldn't believe that I had been yelling at Santa Claus. And that everything was lost now because Santa heard me. And you know what? I love it all. I love that Christmas. I love seeing Santa Claus and getting giddy, even on the highway and in the snowstorm. I love all of it because I have something that is great joy. I received Jesus Christ as my Savior because I believe that the angel said, you don't have to have fear. I've got good news. Jesus is the good news, and it brings great joy. So bring it on, IRS. Bring it on, healthcare. Bring it on. Bring out all the troubles of this world, because for me, I can just sit back and say, I have no fear. I can face all these things because Jesus gives me faith. And I have a great joy that isn't dependent upon circumstances. Do you have that great joy today? This Christmas, I can experience God's great joy. I'm wrapped in Christ's love. Twice this week, I shared this verse at funerals. Twice in 1 week, these verses. For I am convinced that neither life nor death, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things of this world can separate me from the love of Jesus. I'm convinced. I am convinced. It brings me great joy to know that in all the troubles and in all the fears that pop up, I'm surrounded and enveloped by Christ's love. That brings me great joy. I want to light another tree. I just want to put more lights up. Because I have something that people don't have. They see the parade, but they don't have the joy. I get the joy. I have a daily joy that's immeasurably better than temporary happiness. John 10:10. Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and have it to its full. I'm telling you, I'm making a strong case for lighting Christmas trees this week. Christians for so long have been so fighting against Christmas, and I'm saying, let's embrace it, people. Let's go for it. Let's let the whole world know that we're more excited than anybody because they only have the parade, but we have the whole deal. So my joy daily is immeasurably better than temporary happiness. Why? Because Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and have it to its full. Are you experiencing the fullness of faith? Or are you totally suppressed by fear? You can experience a life of joy, daily joy. Fear not. Everybody say fear not. Everybody say good news. Everybody say great joy. Oh, we got it all. See, I have a secure destiny. Remember when I read Hebrews earlier? It's appointed unto men once to die. And after that, the judgment. There's some verses you just got to read depressed. That's a depressing verse. But this is a great verse. Turn with me to Romans.
Romans chapter 3. Nope, Romans 10. If you start in Romans 3, read all the way to 10, it should bring you great joy. Romans 10, 11 through 13 says this. For the scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. There's no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Great faith conquers fear. Let's point around a man once to die. And after that, the judgment. And anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Great joy. Some people in this world are only going to see the parade this season. They're going to miss out on possibly great joy to know that there's a Savior. To understand that death is not the final lap. There's more to this life. There's more to this life. And then my favorite part of this passage. The angels say, fear not, I've got good news. It's going to bring you great joy. And it's for, everybody say it with me, all people. I just love this. Because all means all, and that's all means, and I'm an all. You're an all. We're all alls. Will, you're an all. Thanks for bringing chicken noodle soup this week, by the way. Take good care of me. I appreciate that. All. All means all. And the Bible says, the angels tell us that you don't need to fear. I got good news. That's going to bring you great joy. It's for everybody. It's for everybody. I love that. I'm not left out. You're not left out. All people. This Christmas, I must share God's love with all people. All people have been given the story. That's why the angels came to the shepherds, not just to the palace. That's why the angels made sure everybody heard about it. It's for all people. Why? The Bible says, I'll go through this quickly. The Bible has a lot of alls in it. One of the alls is all have sinned. Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's an all statement. Well, the angels broke through and said, it's for all. The good news, great joy is for all people, but the facts are that all people are also sinful people. And Jesus came for all. Let's look at that. Look at Luke 19. Luke chapter 19. Jesus came for all people. All of us sinners. If we're all sinners, why would Christ come? Well, he came for sinners. Luke 19. Verse 10. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Everybody say the lost. All are lost. The Bible says, for all have sinned, fall short of God's glory. But Jesus came for all the lost. All people can have great joy. Because Jesus came for all people. Jesus died for all. Romans 5:8. Let me read that for you. Romans 5 and verse 8. But God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Friends, the good news of Christmas that brings great joy is that Jesus was born. And he's for all of us sinners. He came for all of us sinners. And he died for all of us sinners. One thing that became incredibly apparent to me this week is I've seen nothing but fears. I've seen nothing but heartache this week and really scary situations. One thing occurred to me over and over and over again this week. God doesn't save perfect people. He came and died for all of us as we are, and we're messed up people. Messy situations, messy families. We've just been preaching through the Old Testament showing you that all families were dysfunctional families, and it's because of that that Christ lovingly came. In the midst of chaos, you don't have to clean up. You don't have to act right, look right. Some people stay away from church. Some people avoid this kind of a gathering like the plague. Why? Because they're afraid they're going to get judged. There are some people that are missing out on something we have, this family, because they're afraid they'll be judged. And what I want to scream out, for all the things I've heard this week, I just want people to know, come. Come join the messy family here at Oakwood, because we're all just sinners saved by grace. We all had baggage, but Christ took it, he checked it, he said, put it away. We're all lost people. But Christ died for all. He came for all. He loves us all. I love that fact of Christmas. And all can be saved. The last verse I want to read for you and we'll be done. 1 Timothy 2 and verse 4. 1 Timothy 2, verse 4. I'll go back to 3. This is good, and it is pleasing in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of truth. Friends, all people can be saved. Jesus came for all. And if you're here this morning and you never accepted this wonderful gift, these are the best words of Christmas. Fear not. It's good news. It's going to be great joy. It's for everybody. Everybody. What a gift. And friends, I love Christmas. And we should light it up. We should make sure the whole world can't avoid it. But there's more to it. When we get the opportunity, we want to share what's more to this story. I read this week of Irene Lucas. Irene Lucas is an author. But when she was a little girl, her dad, every Christmas, would come home. And on Christmas Eve, he'd come home from work, and he would have the presents and the Christmas tree. This is back in the day. He'd come home from work, and he'd have just enough money that he'd bring home the Christmas tree and the presents. And the kids would always wait, but this year was going to be different. Irene wrote in the story that this year, her dad had been laid off. And on Christmas Eve, there was going to be no presents. There was going to be no Christmas tree. And the hardest thing for her as a little girl, she couldn't imagine Christmas without the Christmas tree. She said her dad knew that the disappointment in the kids was just hard to handle. So he went out to the garage and he found a 2x4, about a 5-foot-long 2x4, and he started drilling holes in the 2x4. And then he went to the neighbor's house. The neighbor's house had rows of evergreens along all three sides of the property, just rows and rows of evergreen trees. He went to the neighbor's house and asked the lady of the house, "Can I just cut off some branches?" She said, "Sure." He explained the situation, and no presents, no Christmas tree, and he was going to make a Christmas tree. So he took that 2x4 with holes in it and took some branches and he stuck it in the 2x4 and brought it home. And little Irene tells the story that she swallowed her disappointment and she was thankful that they were at least going to have a tree, looking at this pathetic 2x4 with branches stuck out of it, when the doorbell rang. She tells the story about going to the door. And there's the next door neighbor lady with her children, with the most beautiful Christmas tree she'd ever seen. And little presents. She said they gave us all little presents, but what mattered is we had this beautiful Christmas tree for Christmas that year. And as Irene got older, she said every year growing up, she couldn't help but to notice the gaping hole in the row of Christmas trees on the neighbor's property, where they had cut down one of their trees to bring it over there. There was a sacrifice. And it was a reminder. But it was a loving sacrifice. And this morning, I just want to let you guys know that the Bible tells us this wonderful story that we have, that the whole world might not know, that there's more to it than the lights and the tinsel and the Hallmark Christmas specials, or freeform, whatever you want to call it now. All the wonderful stuff of Christmas is just the parade. But we have the whole thing. We have the whole message that the angels broke through and said, "Fear not! I bring you good news, great joy, all people." Let's pray. Praise team, if you'd come and close us this morning. Father God, I pray this morning, as we go through this Christmas holiday, God, let us be bearers of this message. We've received it through your servant Luke. We've received what the angels declared, that there's no need for fear, there's good news, there's great joy, and it's for everybody. So God, help us to be bearers of this great news. God, may we shout it loud, may we announce it, proclaim it, may we light it up, may we show our neighbors that we have joy. We have joy, unspeakable, unsearchable, unexplainable joy, Even though there's fears, we have faith that overrides all fears. So God bless us this holiday. May we be bearers of this good news. May we share with everyone we come in contact with the reason for the hope that we have. The reason why there's peace when there seems to be no reason for peace. And there's joy when there doesn't seem to be a reason for joy. God, help us to be people that have more than just the parade. We pray it in Jesus' name.
Stand with us. Let's close our worship with the call to come in.
make the call. The Soul Fire is not going to happen tonight. The weather doesn't seem to be letting up or doesn't plan on letting up. We don't want teenagers out there driving. So if teens stay home tonight, families enjoy one another. Go in peace. God bless.